I'm so sorry, but a little extra exercise. The scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, verse 5 through 9. So the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with defiled hands?" He replied, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules.' You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions." And he continued, "You have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions." The word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So Rob's out this morning, and we're going to do a series on complacency for the month of September. So we're going to be talking about that. Sermon titled, "The No Comfort Zone Zone." I've been worried about that all week. I don't know if it's grammatically correct. Sermon titles aren't exactly my comfort zone writing. So let's talk about complacency. It's not maybe the most fun thing to talk about, maybe not the easiest thing to talk about, but we all slip into it from time to time. So I just want to start with defining complacency. So according to the Oxford Annotated Dictionary, complacency is a feeling of smug or uncritical satisfaction with oneself or one's own achievements. And here's another definition. I really like this one and relate to this one a little more. A feeling of calm satisfaction with your own abilities or situation that prevents you from trying harder. So I have a story to go along with this from my high school days. So this is complacency in my life summed up. So I was in marching band in high school. I was very cool, very respected. And I loved marching band. I loved marching season. Right? I didn't like band camp as much. I hated having to memorize the music, but I loved the competition. Right? You got to go out there and compete against other schools, and you got to beat people or get beaten by people. But I liked that. I'm very competitive. I really enjoyed marching band. I really gave it my all. But marching band would end in November, and we would come to the end of the semester, and we'd get ready for spring for concert band. I hated concert band. You don't get to get out. You don't get to move. You're just sitting in the room, and you're a tuba player, so most of the time, you're not really doing anything. And so every year when marching band would end and concert season would start, we'd have 2 weeks to prepare for chair placements, the dreaded chair placements. And I don't want to brag, but I was fourth chair all 4 years of high school. Out of four. And I worked very hard. I earned it. I drew on my sheet music. I made sounds and announcements in my tuba. My band directors loved me. And so every year when it came time for chair placements, we had to learn all these scales. They gave us like 12 scales we had to learn. And, you know, I'd been marching all season. I memorized all the season's music. What else do you want from me? You want me to memorize all these scales? So my first year, my freshman year, I memorized my B-flat scale. And so when I went in and was asked to play these scales for my first chair placement, I played the B-flat scale, no matter what they asked me. And so the pattern continued sophomore year, junior year. In my senior year, I decided, you know what, I'm going to get serious. I'm going to take my tuba home and actually practice. I got all excited about it. I said, I'm a senior now. Maybe I can get to the third chair or the second, or heck, maybe I even get to the first and get the nice silver tuba with all the valves on it that's not leaking all the time. But, you know, the 2 weeks came and went, and I hadn't practiced any of my scales. And I went to chair placements, and the director looks at me and he says, "John Connor, are you going to waste your time and mine this year?" I said, "No, sir, I'm ready. I'm prepared. I know all my scales. Just ask me anyone you want. I've got you." And he said, "Okay." And he asked me some I don't know, 2-octave chromatic scale, something difficult, something that I should have known as a senior. So I straighten up in my chair, adjust my tuba, take a deep breath, and I go ba 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 ba, B flat scale. And he looks at me and he says, "Get out." So there I was again, 4th chair, all 4 years. And I was comfortable. I was comfortable with the B flat scale. I didn't care to learn any of the other ones. I knew that one. I didn't care to be any better than I was. I didn't care for going for honor band or lions band. That took too much effort, too much work. I was much happier just goofing off and having a good time. But that's complacency. When we get comfortable where we're at and we stop growing, we stop pushing ourselves, we stop challenging ourselves, we stop letting people challenge us. And so over time, as we grow more and more complacent, we leave our comfort zones less and less. Right? Does everyone know what a comfort zone is? I think we're all pretty familiar. The things that we're comfortable with in our faith, the things that we know that we can do, we usually stick with that. We usually don't venture out in anything else. Right? We don't deal with the scary. We don't deal with the uncomfortable. And so we spend our time daily doing only what we enjoy or what we're familiar with. And when that happens, we stop taking risks. We stop growing. If you do the same thing over and over, you know that one thing and you're good at that, but you're not growing, you're not doing anything else. Right? If you only practice a B flat scale, it's the only one you're going to know. And so in our spiritual lives, complacency, this feeling that we think we've got it, we think we're good where we're at, is really, really dangerous. Right? And it's so dangerous because it's stealthy. It sneaks up on us over time. It's a gradual decline. The Pharisees, in that passage in the scripture this morning, they were complacent. They were good. They were satisfied where they were. They didn't care about growing. They didn't care about anything new. They held to these traditions that they'd been doing for thousands and thousands of years. It's what they knew. It's what they were good at. But they were more concerned with what they had achieved than what God was achieving through them or what God could achieve through them. They became comfortable. They became complacent. And they spent their time trying to stay that way. And so they began to value their own words, their rules, their laws above God's laws. Right, Jesus said these are just man-made rules. And so when we spend our time studying our laws, our will, our words, we spend less time in God's will. We try to maintain our comfort. We worry about what we want, right? What's comfortable for us, what's good for us. We lose sight of God, and then when that happens, we become our own gods. We're just trying to do our will when we're just trying to please ourselves. We become our own gods. So the Pharisees and the teachers in this passage weren't used to their authority being challenged, right? That's what was different about Jesus. He had an authority that nobody ever saw, and they didn't understand it, and it scared them and it threatened them so much so that they plotted to kill him. They weren't used to being challenged. Their word was law. If they said something that wasn't right, it became law. And so what Jesus said to them was a challenge. He pushed them. He stretched them. It made them uncomfortable, took them out of their comfort zone. And while it's really easy to look at the Pharisees and to get onto them, to chastise them, we could take this passage and it could just as easily apply to us, couldn't it? I can imagine times in my life, more recently than I like to admit, where this is applicable to me. I think if we're honest, we've all had that moment. Jesus sums it up best when he quotes Isaiah. He says, "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." To me, that's as a Christian, as a Christ follower, that's the scariest thing that can happen. When his name's on our lips, but our hearts are far from him. And so when we become complacent as followers of Christ, our spiritual disciplines begin to fall by the wayside. Right? What was important becomes less important. Right? Instead of reading our scriptures every day, maybe we put it off and it drops to a few times a week. Maybe it drops to one time a week. Maybe we only pray a few times a week where we used to pray every day. And so when that happens, we stop reading the scriptures as often, we stop having a conversation, we stop praying with our Heavenly Father, we're trading spending time with Jesus for Jesus culture. Right? And what is Jesus culture, you might ask? To me, right, it's people who are willing to talk about Jesus. Right? They buy the t-shirt, they've got the shirt, they'll invite you to church, they'll tell you about what their church is doing. Right? They'll tell you about the things that Jesus has done in the past, the prayers that they've had answered years ago. They'll tell you about all these past things that God's done through them, but they're not necessarily having an ongoing relationship where they're engaging Jesus on a regular basis. And we can slip into that really easily, right? We substitute reading the scripture for maybe listening to praise and worship songs, right? And instead, we substitute it. We talk about Jesus and not to him. And when we're focused on our past experiences, when we're satisfied with what God's already done and what he did in our lives, we stop looking forward to what he's going to do. We stop looking at the now, at what he's doing in our lives, how he's moving now, how he wants to use us now. If we would just let him, if we would just step out of that comfort zone. And a lot of times what he's asking us to do is new, and it is scary, because we're always supposed to be growing. We're always supposed to be being refined. So we rely too much on our comfort zones. We stop challenging ourselves, much less let anyone else challenge us, right? How dare you say anything to me? Do you know how long I've taught Sunday school? Do you know how long I've been a member here? So we get some of that smugness sometimes. We can get an ego. We don't like to be challenged. So then if we say no more challenges, those challenges become obstacles. The obstacles become barriers, and they get higher and higher and harder to jump over. And before you know it, the barriers become excuses. Right? Everything is an excuse. And before long, you're left talking about what we should have or could have or would have done. If. What if? Instead of talking about what Jesus is doing. And that's what will happen if we don't leave our comfort zones on a regular basis. Now hear this. Don't hear comfort zone and complacency and confuse it with contentment. Because we are called to be content. And Paul talks about that. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And he did. He was a well-respected, wealthy man. And he was a poor man who was beaten and abused and jailed. Right? He knew the secret to contentment. It's Jesus. And so wherever we go, whether we're in our comfort zone or not, Christ is there and he's with us. But don't confuse contentment with complacency. Because the call of Christ is not to lead lives of comfort, right? Most of the time it's the opposite. As I mentioned, Paul, the other disciples, most of them died as martyrs, right? And they were just poor, humble fishermen, most of them. They didn't know how to be preachers. They didn't know how to heal people. They weren't equipped for that. They were the guys who weren't good enough. They weren't good enough to be scribes. They weren't good enough to be Pharisees and priests. But Jesus saw something in them. He knew that they could be more. He knew that if he took them out of their comfort zone, out of the complacency that they were in, that they would do great things because he was with them. And so we aren't called to be stagnant. We're not called to be unmoving. We're not called to be unchanging. The Bible makes it clear that we should always, always be growing and moving towards Jesus, towards the goal. Right? As Paul said, running the race. And the greatest challenge to our comfort zones that Jesus ever gave us was the Great Commission. Matthew 28, when he said, "Go and make disciples." Go is a scary word when you're stuck in your comfort zone. Right? To be stuck means to have your feet planted. You are there. You're immovable. And so we might want to, right, serve him. We might want to get out of that spot, but we literally can't go and make disciples. We can't do what Jesus calls us to do when we're stuck, when we can't move. So our comfort zone becomes a place of inaction, excuses, procrastination. And we can't live out the gospel if we don't make an effort to step out of it at least once in a while, right? And it's there to retreat back to when you need it, right? But if we never step out of it, we'll never grow. We'll never do anything new. We'll never do anything different. Being a disciple is risky. It's one of the riskiest things we can do for our reputations, our pride, especially our complacency. There are things at risk when we step out in faith, right? What would this person think if I shared them? Would they think I'm some kind of Jesus nut, right? All the word Bible thumper, all the things you could throw out. We get scared. We don't want to step on toes. We don't want to hurt feelings. We don't want to offend. But again, Jesus gave us this commission. Go and make disciples. It's what we're called to do. So I want to encourage you today, if you've thought about this or if you haven't, maybe you've seen some of the signs of complacency in your life. Maybe you're fine with where you're at. But I just want to challenge you. It's going to look different for everybody. What's that thing in your walk and in your faith that makes you uncomfortable? What's that thing that's a little scary, a little frightening? I just want to encourage you to do something out of the ordinary this week. Do something different. Break out of that routine of complacency, of comfortability. Do something that makes you uncomfortable. All right, do something a little risky. Step out of that comfort zone. Because I promise you, when you do, it might be scary, it might be challenging, it might be hard, it's going to be uncomfortable. But God is with you. Christ will walk that road with you, and you may not know what's ahead, you may not know what's on the other side, but He does. And He's guiding you, and He will always be with us, and He will never forsake us. So as you leave today, just remember that we're called to a faith that is risky, uncomfortable, and sometimes just scary. Because faith is a no-comfort zone. I just encourage you all to live into that this week and to step out.
Honor for sharing gift of the word with us this morning.